China's stock market is hot, hot, and hot, and it just might return to the $10 trillion valuation again, 5 years since its market's dramatic crash. That milestone could actually happen anytime this week. So, what's the buzz and the fuzz all about? Has the market become too hot to handle? Adamas Asset Management's Brock Silvers helps us make sense of the irrational. Or is it? Brock, thank you so much for joining us.
Great to be here today.
So, is China's remarkable $1 trillion rally irrational, or is there logic behind the madness? Is this 2014 all over again? I mean, debt-fueled speculative frenzy and then a painful crash?
I think the rally is at least significantly irrational. It just doesn't seem to me to be backed up by the underlying economic fundamentals. You know, remember, only last year, before the pandemic, China came in with the worst GDP growth in 30 years. And in the intervening year, it's been just a litany of trade war and decoupling and pandemic, none of which is helpful for the economy. So the real question is, why are we booming? Well, basically because the government has told everyone it expects the markets to go up. And I think that people are much more, the market is much more emotional in China than it is, for instance, in the US. And that's the reaction. The market, the government says up and the market goes up a bit.
Mm-hmm. But Brock, you've got data from the China Securities Depository and Clearing Corporation showing that virtually all investors in mainland stock markets are individual traders. What does that imply? I mean, are people able to partake in this $1 trillion jump? That's a pretty substantial amount of money.
Sure. Look, if we believe the data that this rally is really being driven on a retail level, what that tells us is that Beijing has a very big and very effective megaphone. However, when I look at some of the volumes, I'm honestly not completely convinced that there's not something else working alongside the retail investment increase. So the data may not be fully capturing some of the non-retail movement.
So what are you seeing as something else working alongside the retail? What's the story underneath this too fast, too high jump in the China stock market?
Sure. Well, you know, even in the last week, Beijing itself has really come out and said, look, the rally may be getting out ahead. We may be getting ahead of ourselves. And miraculously, what happened immediately thereafter? Well, state-connected funds started to sell down their portfolios. So, believe me, that's not a coincidence. That's because Beijing is again sending a signal to the market. Now, if these institutional players are reacting to that signal, that sort of cuts against the grain of this idea that the rally itself was completely retail-driven.
Brock, you know, you're calling this Chinese rally as something that projects Beijing's preferred image of a thriving, successful
right.
society. How much of it is projected and how much of it is true, you think? I mean, all of us from outside are viewing China as first in, first out of the COVID curve. We're all waiting for second quarter GDP to come out on Thursday after a beat on trade numbers. We're all hoping to see good numbers because everybody here is hoping if China did it, maybe we can do it too. Maybe that's the playbook we follow.
Sure. Look, I'm still a big believer in the long-term China story. China has been a great investment for many years, and I think it will be for years to come. But right now, there's more than a bit of projection in the current image of affluence and economic success. The numbers may have bottomed out. We'll see in the coming days. But we already know that the numbers are not good. The thing to remember here is that we will stabilize and get beyond the pandemic at some point, and I happen to think it'll be sooner than many of my colleagues believe. But when that happens, the pre-pandemic China economy, I don't think, is coming back. I see the pandemic as a line of demarcation between the old and new economic systems. China's economic model is going to have to evolve. And I think that will happen, but it hasn't happened yet. And in the interim, there's going to be a bit of economic chaos. And I think what we're seeing now is some corresponding projection.
Mm-hmm. And what do you see as the primary differences between the new and old economic models of China?
You know, China had a particular way of growing its economy, and I think some of those methods have just reached the end of their natural lifespan. For instance, infrastructure spending. When you start from a very low base, you get extremely positive returns on infrastructure spending, but at this point, China's infrastructure is fairly well developed, and those marginal returns decrease over time. That's just one example, but I think China's going to have to find, if it wants to resume high growth rates, it's going to have to redefine the system, and that will probably require some economic opening measures. And the problem there is that sometimes those are not politically easy.
Mm-hmm. By opening measures, you mean opening up the economy to more foreign investors, more foreign money coming in?
In some regards, yes, mm-hmm. but more integration into global economic systems would certainly be helpful. You know, remember, it's still the currency doesn't freely trade. There are still capital controls. There are still lots of restrictions that prevent China's full integration into the global economy. And I think that those will come down over time. But right now, there's sort of a battle between growth and economic reform, and we'll have to see how that plays out.
Mm-hmm. We'll talk more about infrastructure later. But I wanted to bring this up because it's not every day that we hear a former official make the case for a need for a bull market to offset economic headwinds. The former chairman of the China Securities Regulatory Commission said that the central leading body of the Chinese Communist Party has never attached as much importance to the capital market as it does now. How relevant is Wall Street to Main Street has always been a hot topic for discussion. So now I ask you, how relevant or crucial is the Chinese stock market to the fundamental industries?
Well, look, I think the former chairman's statement is correct. You know, Beijing has never paid as much attention to capital markets from 1949 until today as it does right now. And the question we should ask is, why is this? And I see the root of this as It's really come from the trade dispute with the U.S. and the overall deterioration in the Sino-U.S. relationship. Because for decades, it's really been U.S. Wall Street finance that has powered Chinese growth. And that's been great. It's been good for China. It's been good for the U.S. investment side. It's been good for everyone. But given where we're heading with decoupling, there's a real threat that Wall Street may close some doors to China in the near future. And I think that China is simply trying to grow its own capital markets capabilities so as to ensure their own access to capital going forward. And viewed in this light, it seems entirely rational.
Mm-hmm. But hopefully this would not be speculative, because at the end of the day, the stock market is hot money. It's very easy to put money in, just as easy and fast to take money out.
And look, in China, it's hotter money than it would be in other developed markets like the U.S. Certainly, there's a higher emotional component to the market out here.
Mm-hmm. You know, let's talk about the China recovery. I hope this is where we end on a good note, because President Xi Jinping has promised unprecedented spending on new infrastructure, including 5G networks, to offset the COVID fallout. I mean, Guangdong, a manufacturing heartland, has committed to building 20 high-tech industrial estates by 2022. Do you think this is the way to go for China to stay relevant on the global stage? Or could this lead the giant into a fiscal cliff? And let's not forget that the doors are closing on China's 5G play, because the U.S. has turned it down, the U.K. has turned it down. So what gives?
Yeah, that's right. Look, China has turned to infrastructure at every hint of a slowdown for quite a few years at this point. So Xi Jinping's proposal isn't unusual. It's almost to be expected. And at this point, China certainly has the capital to invest if they decide to do so. But look, I still am a firm believer that markets and corporates make much more rational investment decisions than bureaucrats do. And China over the years has made quite a few decisions that have left the country, in my opinion, with a lot of infrastructure that is, let's say, less than economically derived, that perhaps wouldn't have been built in a more rational economic system. So What we have to ask ourselves is whether the new 5G impetus is going to follow that same path, or whether they'll see a higher sort of return on investment for those dollars. And we don't really know yet. China may be able to pull this off. However, as you say, look, the rest of the world seems to be galvanizing against China on the 5G issue. And if that's the case, if that turns out to be the case, some of this investment may be regretted in the end. But we'll have to see.
Okay. Until then, we'll have to talk to you again when that happens. Thank you very much, Brock, for joining us this afternoon.
Thank you.